I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I made. I was breathing on a all my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn, yeah, till I made. You called my name and I
in my body. Morning, church. That was a great time. If you didn't participate or you weren't there, the Fall Festival was a lot of candy and joy and happiness. It was awesome. Thank you to everyone who was volunteering for that. As we open up with service, we're going to read Psalm 129, 119. Can you hear me now? All right. So stand with me in honor of reading God's Word. Starting in verse 129, your testimonies are wonderful, therefore my soul keeps them. The unfolding of your words gives light, and it imparts understanding to the simple. I open up my mouth and pant because I long for your commandments. Turn to me and be gracious to me, as is your way with those who love your name. Keep steady my steps according to your promise, and let no iniquity get dominion over me. Redeem me from man's oppression, that I may keep your precepts. Make your face shine upon your servant, and teach me your statutes. Let's pray. Jesus, we come to you this morning, Lord, with open hearts. Lord, humble us. Allow us to be reverent in your house and in your presence. Lord, there's many who came today with joys and praises and good things going on in their life, but there's many of us who came with brokenness and pain. Lord, help us to be reverent in your presence. God, it's all about you. Lord, let us worship you in spirit and in truth today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand. You're already standing. That's great. Let's worship our King this morning.
Worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his wonderful love, our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by fading tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. I was lost in utter darkness, till you came and rescued me. Sin when your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone. Come thou clouds, come thou wind, come thou precious Prince of Peace. Hear your cries, to you we sing. Come thou fount of all blessing. Come thou fount, come thou wind, come thou precious Prince of Peace. Hear your cries.
Good morning, church. Okay, so I'm going to do the birthday and anniversary announcements first. I did not get the actual years. I just got the years of birth and years of marriage. And I am not good with math. That's why I went to law school. So if I got your birthday and your years of marriage wrong. Sorry. So, on November 9th, Ruth Hooper will be celebrating her 85th birthday. On the 15th, Margie Pratt will be celebrating her 87th birthday, I think. Okay, so anniversaries, and I'm going to mess this last name up because Joe was not here to confirm how to announce it, so I apologize. Ron and Alice Corvea? Corvo? Oh, there's a lot of extra letters there. Corvo? they are celebrating their 66th wedding anniversary. And Pam and Herb Pittman are celebrating their 54th wedding anniversary. So happy birthday and happy anniversary. All right, so we want to thank everybody that helped and came and supported the Fall Festival. It was a great success, like the slide showed. I think everyone had a good time. We also want to give a special thanks to Kelly and Ron from Pop Fusions. I don't know if anybody tried, but they gave out free popsicles to everybody that was at the Fall Festival. So just another round of applause for them. That was huge. We will be installing the flags on Monday, November 8th, tomorrow. So meet at the church at 9 a.m. And if you have questions, another name, sorry, I'm not good with this, Greg Ryer? Did I do it? All right. If you have any questions, contact him. I don't know how to contact him, but ask around. Okay, there will be a blood drive next Sunday on the 14th. Joe wanted me to make sure I tell you guys you are not required to give all of your blood, but just like tithing, 10% will be great. Upward Soccer is coming up. Registration is open. If you have kids, grades 3 through 7th grade, register them. If you don't have kids but you still want to help out, you can sponsor a child for $60, I believe it is. To help, you can come out to the games, encourage the kids. It's always fun when you have like a big crowd out there because they get super excited. So if you have any questions, just contact Joe or Nick about that. The OCC, Operation Christmas Child, there is a Atlanta trip meeting on Wednesday at 5:30 in room 174. Either A or B, you got a 50-50 chance. Any questions, talk to Pastor Byron. There will be a packing party as well for the Operation Christmas Child. That will be this Wednesday. All ages are encouraged to come. It'll be fun, it'll be exciting, and let's pack those gifts. Father-Son Retreat is going to be at the church on November 19th at 5 p.m., staying overnight. The dads are getting a better dinner than the kids, but I'm not going to say what it is because some of the kids are in here. But the kids are getting hot dogs and the men are getting real meat. So if you have any questions about that, talk to Joe or Nick as well. We will be having the First Baptist Family Thanksgiving dinner on Sunday, November 21st. It's really going to be a lunch, but we'll be having Thanksgiving lunch. On the 21st, everyone is encouraged to bring a side. There'll be little dishes out in the foyer area. After service, you can grab whatever side you want to bring. If I remember correctly, they're all like labeled, so you don't forget what you signed up for, unless you lose your pan. But they have them at Publix really, really cheap. So yeah, I think that's all the announcements. Oh, and this wasn't on my list, but I saw it in here. There's a town meeting, which I'm guessing is just like a meet and greet kind of thing, but it's discussing the potential sale of 4 acres of church property. So that will be on the 17th at 6 p.m. So if you have any questions, that's the time to come to raise them, ask questions, inquire about anything. And then the final vote will be on Sunday, November 28th at the end of service. And I think that's everything I have. Have a good one.
We have a very special guest this morning. Some others I found out this morning had done the honor flight, but Mr. Ray Morrison wanted to come up and
tell you a little bit about the most recent one that he went on, which was just very recently, past couple of weeks. The quilt is one that was given to him as long along with the hat. I'm going to ask Mr. Ray to come up and grab that mic and tell us a little bit about his journey.
Good morning. Takes a little effort to get up and move. On Wednesday, October the 20th, I was honored and blessed to be on an honors flight to Washington, D.C. with 65 other veterans. First picture, please. We boarded the bus, or we were picked up about midnight and delivered to the American Legion Hall in Ladies Lake. Well, when we got there, the place was like chaos. There were so many people there. But basically what we did there, we had some procedures to go through and to get our badges. We said the Pledge of Allegiance, and then we boarded the bus. And on the way out, there was an honor guard at the door. And throughout the day, there were honor guards all over the place. Well, we boarded the bus, and we had an escort out of town by the police department. Well, when we arrived at the Sanford Airport, you could only feel a little pride. Everybody in the airport was applauding us, thanking us for our service. So it was a few tears to begin with. So anyway, we had breakfast, and we boarded the flight for the Baltimore airport. And in Baltimore, when the plane was taxiing up, we got our first water cannon salute, which there were several throughout the day. But anyway, as we were passing through the airport, there was a young man standing at the entrance. He saluted each one of us as we passed through. Well, we boarded the bus, and we had I'll call it a motorcycle club rather than a gang, but they were our escort into D.C. Well, the first place that we went to in D.C., next film, please. Wasn't a blank wall. Anyway, we lost it. But the first memorial we went to was the Air Force Memorial. And it's a very simple but beautiful memorial. It has three spires that simulate the Blue Angels when they bail out on a flight, sort of peel off, I should say. Anyway, we had a picture of the four Air Force cadets. And when we, if you're ever there, you're going to be asked, there's four, one is odd, one is different, can you identify it? And you say, sure, it's the one on the right, it's a woman. So that makes you look like you're very observant. Anyway, we had lunch there, and the chief of staff for the Air Force, who was also a member of the Joint Chiefs, spoke to us while we had lunch. And after that, we boarded the bus and went to the Arlington National Cemetery. Okay, there's the four statues, and the one on the right is a woman. So anyway, we boarded the bus and went to the Arlington National Cemetery. And from there we went to, now that's a little, that's the World War II Memorial. We're out of sequence, but that's okay. This is the World War II Memorial, which was the last memorial that was constructed And as you look at it, the columns represent the 48 states that existed during World War II. And the sequence of the states is when they bordered, joined the Union. On the wall across the fountain from the entrance is 44,000 gold stars. They represent the 4,500 soldiers that died in World War II. So after that, we left. Next film, please. Okay, this is back to the National Cemetery. This is the changing of the guards. Very emotional, very popular. Anyway, the soldiers, they guard the tomb, and they take 21 steps in front of the tomb, and their rifle is always carried on the shoulder opposite the tomb. When they change the guard, the sergeant comes in. Next film, please. Okay, this one, a little soon, but anyway, when the sergeant comes in, he has a way of scuffing his heels, which will recognize and honor all of the veterans that's present. And when the guard comes in, he marches up to the tomb and he salutes it, marches back, and he and the relief guard then marches up and the exchange takes place. But this day we were honored for the changing of the wreath. And it's a little lengthy, but we shortened it. What happens is a guard and the bugler comes in with the wreath and marches up. Dignitaries are in the stands, and the two dignitaries are marched or bent down, and they take the wreath and they change it. Then the bugler plays the traps, and then we left there. That's when we went to the World War II Memorial. Next film. Now this is the end. But anyway, we saw the World War II Memorial. Then we left there. And we had about 2 hours. So as we were leaving, we don't have a picture of it, but there was a gentleman there that was imitating General Patton. He had the helmet, the uniform, everything but the two pearl handle pistols. We walked the mall up to the Lincoln Memorial, and on the right side was the Vietnam Memorial, which we didn't attend because, frankly, we left it for the Vietnam veterans. It gets sometimes pretty emotional at that memorial. So we went up to the Lincoln Memorial. From there, we walked over to the Korean Memorial. The Korean was the first memorial that was put on the mall. And we couldn't see much because they were reworking it. And they were also adding an addition, which included a fence, but the memorial has 19 individual soldiers that represent all of the military that was in Korea. There's 19 of them, which represents half of the 38, which represents the 38th parallel, which divides Korea. We saw a Marine detachment that came out in front of the Lincoln Memorial and did a close arms drill. Very, very good. We went past them, and it looked like high school kids. But these guys are trained. They're well trained. We boarded the bus back to the Baltimore Airport. And when we arrived at the airport at Sanford, as we were coming out, we came down to the first level, And there was an honor guard. And then this picture here is a group with bagpipes that were playing songs and with the drums. And I don't know if you can see it or not, but one of the drummers was a young girl, no more than 8 or 9 years old, and she was doing a great job with it. We parted there, we got back on the bus, and came back to Lady Lakes. On the way, we stopped at the parking lot in Walmart, and I thought, you know, we all love Walmart, but at 3 buses at midnight. Anyway, we pulled in, and here were 98 motorcycles and 10 Corvettes that was going to be our escort back to the American Legion Hall. So anyway, we left. The motorcycles looked like they stretched out for a mile. Anyway, we pulled back into the lot of the American Legion, and we received another water cannon salute. Well, when we were getting off of the bus, I got a little choked up. There was my daughter and son-in-law and Laverne. My daughter and son-in-law made a special trip down from Atlanta to be there for me. So anyway, we went through, this is the cannon at when we were coming into the lodge. Anyway, we watched through a honor guard. And when we got in there, there were, probably, I would estimate, more than 300 people surrounding the parking lot. And in the parking lot, they had 66 chairs. And they went through a lot of ceremony, but the what we enjoyed most was they honored each veteran by name, branch of service, and when they entered the service. And they did this for all 66 of us. Also, if the guardian was a veteran, they acknowledged the guardian in the same manner. After closing prayer, went home. Well, in our chair, we had a package, a special cap, and some souvenirs. Well, the next morning after I got up, I opened the package, and I had quite a few letters. I had a letter from the governor, both senators, 2 representatives, and our mayor. And I looked at them, and we had 30 letters from my church family. Thank you. They were beautiful. Before I finish, I have to do a couple of things. One, I have to thank the quilting ladies for this beautiful quilt, which they presented to me the Sunday before the flight. And so, ladies, thank you. Thank you very much. I'm using it already. So, and also, another person that was involved heavily in this trip, they made a lot of phone calls. They coordinated a lot of things, but that was my wife, Laverne Register Morrison. Thank you, honey. I love you. Now we're going to see a video to honor all of our veterans. When your service song comes up, stand.
Thank you. Would you do this? Do us the honor of leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please, Mr. Ray.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
Thank you. Please be seated. Thank you very much, Mr. Ray. I appreciate it. Not really sure how I'm supposed to follow that. We're going to... week, we do a family prayer focus. And this morning, we've got some precious families that we want to bring up. It's just because it's alphabetical that the first two happen to be related to each other. Ms. Rachel is Dana's daughter. So Marcos and Rachel, and we don't have a current picture, but you've got to see these twins. These girls are precious. And you've got Kara and Dana, and then Miss Marie, just wonderful, precious people. And we want to, as we bring up these pictures, we're trying to church family is, because there's a number of us, and we're kind of scattered. There's about 3 or 4 months out of the year. Some of you just, you know, you go AWOL. And then, so we're trying to make sure everybody knows everybody, but we also want to pray for one another. And the passage that I want to pray over these precious folks is out of Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21. And as I was praying about and thinking about who they are and their walk with Christ, I love the way that they do this. They practice this. So we're gonna pray it over them. Isaiah 30, verse 21, and your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way. Walk in it when you turn to the right or when you turn to the left. That's one of my favorite promises out of Isaiah. The fact that he guides us every step of the way. Would you pray with me, please? Lord, I thank you for these families. I thank you for the way that you've given healthy births. You've given an opportunity to praise you and glorify you. I thank you for lives of faithfulness. And Lord, I thank you that you promise even every step of the way that you guide, that you protect, you lead us. Lord, I pray that happen this morning. I pray for discernment and wisdom, for understanding. I pray for peace in their homes. I pray for your will to be done in their lives. Overwhelm them with your grace and honor them because they're honoring you. Bless them, Lord. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, one of the things that we're going to start doing is have some of our deacons read the weekly sermon passage, because I want you to get to know some of these folks. We've got some great deacons in the deacon body at our church, and I want to introduce them and let them get to know you. Bruce Nelson is going to be reading this morning out of the book of Acts, chapter 8, so as he's making his way down. You can go ahead and cheat if you want to and grab your Bible and figure out where we're going. Acts chapter 8, beginning in verse 26.
Good morning. My name is Bruce Nelson. I have the privilege of being one of your deacons. And I'm going to read to you the story of Jesus' disciple Philip and how he spreads the good news. And I'm reading from Acts chapter 8 and starting verse 26. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So he started out, and on his way, he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of the treasury of Candace, queen of Ethiopia. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in the chariot reading the book of Isaiah, the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, "Go to the chariot and stay near it." Philip then ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah, the prophet. "Do you understand what you're reading?" Philip asked. "How can I?" he said, "unless someone explains it to me." So he invites Philip to come up and sit with him. And the eunuch was reading the passage of Scripture, and this is from Isaiah 53, 7 through 8. "He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before a shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth." Eunuch asked Philip, "Tell me, please, who is this prophet talking about, himself or someone else?" Then Philip began with the very passage of Scripture and told him the good news of Jesus. And as they traveled the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. Why shouldn't I be baptized?" And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way home, rejoicing. Philip, however, appeared in Azotus and traveled about, preaching the gospel in all the towns until he reaches Caesarea. May God add his blessing to the reading of the word.
Really, the point of that song is to let us know that Christ and Christ alone is the answer. We hear a lot in the world today about ways to God, ways to heaven, but there's only one, and that lays and rests in Christ alone. Let's stand and sing to him.
Power of Christ.
the only way to make us worthy, to make us holy, to bring us into your presence through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. So, Father, let us not take that lightly. Let us understand that we have been bought with a great price. We are no longer our own. We are yours. And yours alone. So, Father, use us. Grow us more into your likeness so that we walk in light of your word by the guidance of your Spirit at all times. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
As you're turning with me to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 8, verse 26, I want to encourage you this morning. I know that it's tempting to come to a point in a worship service and perhaps be observing and just kind of taking it in, listening and appreciating and enjoying the singing and the reading of the scripture and the presentations. And then you come to the point of the sermon and you think, okay, we're gonna hear God's word. And that's good. That's very good. But the challenge is when we get to passages like Acts chapter 8, is that sometimes they can become so cerebral, they can become so much just in your mind, you fail to realize that God does not give us his word just for us to observe it. It comes to mind the passage in the Gospels where Jesus is talking about the seed being thrown, broadcast, and when he broadcasts the seed in the story, in the parable, there's some that falls on the path, and that represents the word of God being distributed and then taken up quickly. There's some that's in some good, not good soil, but soil, and it starts to grow, but it goes up, it grows too quickly, it's snatched away. Some actually grows, but there are thorns, there are things that keep it from producing, and it chokes and it dies, and then there's the good soil. What I'm suggesting is I'm going to tell you an incredible story out of the book of Acts, Acts chapter 8. Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. This is amazing. Philip the evangelist and all that he does and how God uses him. What I'm suggesting this morning is this just becomes a nice story to you, you've missed. Because the book of Acts is not just about, hey, those guys did some really cool things way back when. The book of Acts is about God. It's about the Holy Spirit working through his creation. It's about how God, the Holy Spirit, helps us to get in line with him, to stay with him, to glorify him, to be used by him, to be a part of him. So when we talk about who is your one, we talk about this evangelistic emphasis and this thrust to be a part of God's saving work on this world. We're not talking about, well, you just need to pick one and good luck with that. We're talking about who is God's one for you to be praying about, praying for, sharing with, to be involved with. So when you get to passages like Acts chapter 8, something amazing happens. Instead of just a story about a really cool guy and another really cool guy and a really cool time, you've got, wait a minute. Do you mean that God wants me to be on mission with him? Yes. Do you mean that God, the creator God, the one who made the heavens and the earth just by speaking them, the one who does everything just by his presence outside of creation, allowing all things to work together? He who is in charge, he who is sovereign, he who is majestic, in all of his greatness, in all of his otherness, in all of his transcendence, he is able to deal with you right here and right now. This is what's amazing about Acts chapter 8. And this is why when we get to passages like this, I'm kind of doing the whole, hey, if you've fallen asleep, will you please wake up? If you've already drifted off and you're already thinking about, and I hate to say it out loud, what you're going to have for lunch, listen, it's going to be great. You'll enjoy it. You'll love it. But would you please be right here, right now? Because this is really good. And when we understand that and when we see that, something happens in our walk with Christ. All of a sudden, it becomes less about just wandering and banging our heads against the wall and just doing the best we can to an intimate relationship as a disciple of his that is used by him for his glory. Let me show you. I won't belabor the point, but you really got to see this. Let me show you in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. You may be familiar with the passage.
This is kind of the theme verse for the book of Acts. Just give you a little bit of context real quick. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus is speaking, and he says, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Can I tell you that that is the book of Acts? What happens in the next few chapters in Acts is you have Pentecost. You have the Spirit coming upon those in Jerusalem because God has ordained it. God has directed it. And then what happens from there is as you get into chapters 2, 3, and 4, Peter starts to preach to all of these who are coming as sojourners, as pilgrims to Jerusalem, and they start to go back out. They go back out into Judea, and then they go out beyond that. Then you get into chapter 7, 4, 5, 6, and 7. You've got the story of Stephen. You've got the story of Barnabas. You've got all these wonderful how the Spirit of God is working through the people of God. And then you get into chapter 7 and into the start and beginning of chapter 8. And it talks about how the stoning of Stephen created a persecution that spread people out. Do you get it? All my witnesses in all Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria to the end of the earth. And it talked about how the disciples of Christ, not the immediate apostles, but the disciples, those outside of the chosen 12, they started to go out through Judea. It says that, Acts chapter 8. And then Philip, one of those who was chosen in Acts chapter 6 as one of the servants, one of the deacons, precursor to deacons, he goes into Samaria. And then as Philip is encountering the eunuch, according to the Greeks and to the Romans, Ethiopia, which is not really modern-day Ethiopia, it's more like the kingdom of Cush in the Old Testament, Ethiopia was considered the ends of the earth. So the whole book of Acts is Acts chapter 1, verse 8. The whole book of Acts is about how you and I can partner with, be submissive to, be used by God. Let me put it to you from a different angle. If you woke up this morning, if you're listening to this, sitting here online, participating in whatever form or fashion, and we're glad to have you however you are, if you woke up this morning thinking that weird thought that's not from God, I'm a waste of space and I have no reason to be here, I need you to read with me Acts chapter 8. If you think for a moment that you are an accident, that there is no divine plan, that God is not sovereign, he is not all good, he is not all wise, that he is outside and he has no idea what's going on in your world, I need you, just for the next few minutes, walk with me through Acts chapter 8. Because there is so much that we get from the Scripture. Not my opinion, not your opinion, not one person's ideas and another person's ideas. There's so much that we get from the Scripture, the Word of God, that gives us the assurance that you are not an accident. You are not here by chance. This is not a bunch of coincidences. This is not just random, a roll of the dice. This is God who is sovereign and majestic and authority. And he created you the first time. And by the grace of God, if you'll surrender your heart to him, he'll recreate you the second time. There's so much to him that he does for you, and that's what we're going to read about. So go with me now to Acts chapter 8, and let's pick up the story of Philip as he encounters the Ethiopian eunuch. Acts chapter 8, beginning in verse 26. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Rise and go toward the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place." And he rose and went. And there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure. He had come to Jerusalem to worship, and he was returning, seated in his chariot, and he was reading the prophet Isaiah, and the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over and join this chariot." I love this. You see the specific? Putting all the pieces together. I've got to tell you a truth that we can get from Acts chapter 8 is the Holy Spirit prepares the way. Sometimes we think that it's all about what we do. It's not. It's about what he does. Sometimes we think that we're the ones in charge. We're not. He is. Sometimes we think that if we don't do it, it's not going to be done. I guarantee you, he was running the universe well before you got here, and he'll be okay with it when you leave. It is all about God. The Holy Spirit was preparing the air. He doing this. He was engaged with his creation. He does not wind the clock and walk away and let it run down on its own. He is not absent. He is not absent-minded. He is not blind. God himself, who is the Holy Spirit, please hear this. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit, all three persons, one being, fully God, fully divine, fully eternal. They are all one God. And as God is putting all of these pieces together, preparing the way, the Ethiopian, who was a treasurer, put it, from the kingdom down in Cush. And as he's coming to Jerusalem, do you think that it's an accident that he came as an outsider to worship? See, he wasn't a Jew. He couldn't be one. He had a physical deformity. And even if he didn't, then he still had a position outside of Israel that he couldn't be a part of the worship like everyone else. But he still had a heart to worship. We see it in the passage when he came down. He came in verse 27, verse 28. He came to Jerusalem to worship. He wanted to understand. And it's not cheap to get a passage of Scripture. It wasn't cheap to get that scroll and to be able to read that passage he's about to read. It's not a coincidence he's there. It's not a coincidence that he's being prepared. It's not a coincidence that he's where he is, doing what he is. God is moving the pieces. It's not a coincidence that the eunuch was on the outside looking in, seeking hope, seeking something, trying to understand what was happening around him. God is in it. God is in the midst of it. God is always working. I'm not telling you that because I think it's a really good idea. I'm not telling you that because I think it sounds good and it would look good on a poster or a bumper sticker. I'm telling you, according to the Scripture, God is moving. This is His creation. This is His world. And we are a part of that. And He is preparing the way as all of the pieces are coming together. I know that for some of us, we have been trained, we have been conditioned, we have been beaten down, where we actually believe that God doesn't care about us, that He has no idea who we are and what we're doing. But if you live by faith and you live by the Word, which is how we as followers of Christ are to live, if you live by faith and you live by the Word, you cannot come to Scripture and see that is even remotely true. You are on God's heart. You are known by God. Doesn't make you the center of the universe. I hate to break it to you. You're one in billions. But you're known by God. He knows exactly what you're doing. He knows every hair on your head. He knows what's going on. And He knows how the pieces need to come together for His glory and for your good. That's what He's dealing with here. As Philip runs up to the Ethiopian, there's something that happens in this exchange, in this encounter. Notice, as Philip is running up, notice in verse 26, angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, "Rise and go toward the south, toward the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." And then in verse 29, the Spirit speaks again and says to Philip, "Go over and join this chariot." What I love about this, it helps us, is because what's happening in this story, this episode, this true event, is hearing and obeying the Word of God. This is not by accident. This is not God speaking and us thinking to ourselves, "Well, that sounds really nice. I'm going to take that into consideration. That might be a good idea." When God speaks, we obey. When God moves, we listen. And we do what He tells us to do. I think this is one of my greatest hang-ups. And just by presumption and just throwing it on you, I think maybe you have an issue with this as well. When we understand that it's not about hearing, debating, deciding, and then obeying. It's hearing and obeying. It's hearing what He tells us through His Word. Hear this, please, not through another person, not through another theory or doctrine, but through His Word. When His Word says, "Forgive as I've forgiven you," you hear it? You got to obey it. When He says, "Go and make disciples," you hear it? You got to obey it. That's what He's talking about here. And many times we get stymied and we get frustrated, we get angry. We say, "God, where are you? What are you doing?" And it's almost like He's not doing this, He's not doing this. And we say it one more time, "He's not doing this," but it's almost like God is in His authority and His sovereignty looking down at us and saying, "What part of step 1, 2, and 3 are you not understanding? You want to be a part of my world. You want to be a part of my mission. You want to be a part of my activity. And you're not even willing to obey the very first, second, and third thing I tell you to do." What Philip was doing, he's demonstrating to us, if we want a vibrant relationship with our Savior, it's not going to be because we cherry pick and say, "Well, that looks really good. I think I'll do that because that's comfortable. But when He tells me that stuff over there, not so much." You don't get to do that. Philip listened, and he heard, and it resonated. And so he rose up, and he went. And when God says, "Go, go." Not almost. Partial obedience is disobedience, not sort of, kind of. Is it possible that this morning, in your walk with your Savior, He has told you what to do? You've gone to His Word. You've got a full assurance from His Word what He wants you to do in a specific circumstance. whether it be forgiveness, whether it be mercy, whether it be hospitality, whether it be love, joy, patience, kindness, gentleness, goodness, self-control, whatever the issue, whatever the circumstance, you've gone to His Word, you've heard from His Word what you are to obey, and you are rationalizing, and you are excusing, and you are dismissing, and you're thinking, well, I'm sure God will change His mind. Are you really sure you want to go down that road? You sure you want to play this game? The beauty and the liberty of this story is that God spoke and Philip said yes. You want to get right with God? I'm not talking about your salvation. I'm talking about your intimacy, your fellowship. Stop procrastinating and start just obeying. You see, what Philip was going through, as you read earlier in Acts chapter 8, he's having a tremendous ministry in Samaria. He's got the mega church in Samaria. And God's telling him, go talk to the one in the middle of nowhere. Now, the world's economy would tell you, that's not very good stewardship. You shouldn't be doing that. But in God's economy, in a thing, program, or a people, more than you're trusting in the God who provides for you. That's what he's doing here. He's saying, I want you to hear me, and I want you to obey me, to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit and do what he says. All right, that's the first part of the story. Then you come into the actual encounter. I love this. Philip obeys. He goes up to next to the chariot. Chariots were not for poor people. You had to be wealthy to have a chariot. It was probably a couple of oxes. So he was not in a big hurry, but he was going pretty slow, so it's not hard to run up and catch up to it. But look at what happens next. The Holy Spirit prepares the way. The Holy Spirit guides the way. He put all the pieces together. He's directing the path. He's doing what only he can do for his glory and our good. Acts chapter 8, verse 30. Let's pick up the story. So Philip ran to him, heard him reading Isaiah the prophet, not by accident, by the way, asked, do you understand what you are reading? And he said, how can I unless someone guides me? And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this. Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb before its shearer is silent, he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth. And the eunuch said to Philip, about whom, I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else? Then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with this scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. Has gotten this piece of the Old Testament, Isaiah chapter 53, not by accident, is trying to read it and decipher it. It's not by accident he's reading it out loud. In the ancient script, there are no spacing. They're all consonants, especially in the Hebrew, all stuck together. So literally, you had to read it out loud or you couldn't even understand half of what you're reading. So he's reading it out loud, which means he's educated, which means he's got background. It means he's got some understanding, but there's some disconnect. Who is this talking about? What's this all about? And even the debate rages today. 53 is about the prophet Isaiah or about the nation of Israel or about the coming Messiah. We know it's about Messiah. We know it's about Jesus. But he didn't know. Philip knew. And so that's why he started with Jesus and told him the good news, starting in this passage. But because of the Ethiopian, because of his distance, because of his being on the outside looking in, he couldn't get all of this. He couldn't even begin to understand all of this. With me, back to Isaiah. I'm not going to read Isaiah 53, but I encourage you to read it at your leisure. It's a powerful passage that talks about the life, the birth, the life, the death, and the resurrection of Christ. And it's all prophesied hundreds of years before Jesus comes. It's an amazing passage. But I want you to see Isaiah 56, because there's a few chapters later that talks about specifically the Ethiopian's condition. Isaiah chapter 56 in verse 3. Look at this. This is pretty good. Let not the foreigner who has joined himself to the Lord say, the Lord will surely separate me from his people. And let not the eunuch say, there it is, behold, I am a dry tree. For thus says the Lord, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose the things that please me, and hold fast my covenant, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it, and holds fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. The Lord God who gathers the outcasts of Israel declares, I will gather yet others to him besides those already gathered. Do you see it? In this passage in Isaiah, some way, God who created all things is going to bring everyone, every tribe, every tongue, every nation, every ethnicity, everybody's going to come in as a house of prayer. That's why Jesus got so upset about the dealings of the goods in the temple area, because he said it's supposed to be a house of prayer. He wasn't talking just about prayer, which is major. He was saying, I want all people to come in and be able to worship and get communion of God, whether you were born an Israelite or not. And so he gets to this point, and he says, wait a minute, the eunuch. He's reading this passage. He's saying, what is it possible? Is it even conceivable? Dare I hope that I can be with him? That Isaiah 53 is true? That Isaiah 56 actually can apply to me? Here's the beauty of it. When you listen to God, when you follow Jesus, when you let the Holy Spirit prepare the way and prepare the hearts and guide the discussion, it's not by accident that the Ethiopian had the position he had. He was in the place he had. He was doing what he was doing. We've got to get out of our vocabulary this idea of coincidences and accidents. We've got to get out of our vocabulary the idea that the God who created heavens, the heavens and the earth, is somehow on the outside looking in. We've got to get out of this idea that we are helpless and hopeless when we understand who God is and what he is doing. Here's the response to the word of God. Philip, I need you to know it, and I need you to share it. Knowing the Word of God and sharing the Word of God. This is why we don't just have a surface understanding of the Word. It's not why we don't just memorize a few verses and hope they apply to whatever we're going through. It's why we get to the root of it, and we go deeper. So when we come to passages like Isaiah 53, we can say, I can tell you about Jesus from Isaiah 53. When we get to points at the end of the Gospel of Luke, same author, as he's writing, he says that the disciples are walking down the road on the way to Emmaus. Jesus comes up to them, and beginning with the prophets in the Old Testament, he tells them about himself and how their hearts burned within them because he was starting with the Word of God speaking about who he is. The connectors, the bridges, they're about how they are, where they are. Philip understood what the Ethiopian needed, and because of that, he started where the Ethiopian was. I believe one of the failures of our evangelism efforts is that we just kind of throw stuff at people and hope something like spaghetti on the wall sticks. That's not how this works. When you're following Jesus Christ, whenever you're being led as he's preparing the way, there is someone in your world, somebody right now, that God is preparing their heart for what you have to share with them. I wonder how many of you believe that. I wonder how many times we think we can just sit back in the corner and just twiddle our thumbs and hope for the best. When we realize that the Spirit of God is preparing and he is guiding, and our responsibility is to love Jesus more, is to know him more so that we can share him more. Our responsibility is to be plugged in to what he is doing. So let me give you this one little quick example, and then I'll move on. And I apologize to those of you who are thinking the preacher's being way too simplistic. Believe me, it may look like I'm picking fruit from the bottom branch, but this is really high level for me. Here you go. You ready? When you are in a conversation with someone, you ready? Okay. Listen. I know. It's radical. Let me share just one more time in case you didn't have your notes out and you need to write this down. Instead of just telling them what you want to say, listen to them. When they talk about burdens, Word of God. When they talk about Jesus, go to the Word of God. When they talk about what they need, go to the Word of God. How many times do we try to solve each other's problems by modern psychology, by just what we figured out, by man-made methods? When as followers of Christ, we have a God who is preparing the way, who's putting all the pieces together, and as he's guiding that, he's saying, now, I'm going to use you, but the way I use you is not for you just speaking first and thinking later. The way I use you is that you listen to me first, and then you listen to the person first, and then by the grace of God, you become a minister of reconciliation. You bring those two together. That's evangelism. That's where you have the love and compassion toward another human being, where you actually look at them eyeball to eyeball, and you hear their burdens, you hear their needs, you hear where they are at. And as you listen to them, that's loving your neighbor, by the way, loving others as you love yourself. As you listen to them, then you're able to say, because God has shown me this, I'm going to give you this. Knowing and sharing the word of God. Now, I know some of you, perhaps, I don't know anything. That's a terrible thing for a preacher to say, but I'm going to say it anyway. Perhaps some of you are thinking, that's way too easy. Yeah, you're right. Because you're not the one who saves, God's the one who saves. You're not the one who moves, God's the one who moves. You're not the one who gets up the statistics and says, look how many spiritual notches I have in my gun. God's the one who does this. He's the one who's in charge. And when we give him the glory, incredible things start to happen. You sit back and you wonder, how did he bless me so much to be a part of something so great? That's who we are. Come back to Acts chapter 8. Let me wrap this up. Acts chapter 8, we're going to continue the story now. In Acts chapter 8, verse 36. And as they were going along the road, Philip has explained everything. The Ethiopian is listening. He's sharing the good news. He understands it. As they're going along the road, verse 36, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What prevents me from being baptized? And he commanded the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he passed through, he preached the gospel to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. You understand the amazing part about this. As soon as he went down into the water, the eunuch came up and Philip was gone. As soon as that happens here, you guys are running. I'm telling you, you're gonna be out of here quicker than, you're going to be gone. But this is amazing. As God is using Philip, he gets him to the right spot. And you notice the beginning of the story, Philip has to actually put some effort into it. He's the one who's traveling. The end of the story, he gets an express shuttle from here, point A to point B. It's really kind of cool. But the issue is, he's being obedient in whatever way, in whatever form, in whatever fashion. And as the scripture is being opened, as the Spirit of God is leading, the Ethiopian looks up, and do you think it's an accident as they're trotting along in the desert, they come across some water? What are the odds? It's almost like God's in charge. Philip and the Ethiopian, they're reading. The Ethiopian looks up and says, there's water. I'm ready. Is there anything else I need to do? Anything else I need to understand? You've told me about Jesus. I hear it. I see it. So I'm ready. You see, where the Holy Spirit guides, the Holy Spirit provides. See, the Holy Spirit provides the way. Isn't this great? You see, the difference between this and every other religion on the planet is that religion would have you to try harder and harder and harder, and then kind of in the back of your mind wonder if you've tried hard enough. Following God is releasing, 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 denying yourself, taking up your cross, and following him. So your trust is not in yourself, your trust is in him. And as you trust in him day by day, and you seek his face, and you want to be used by him, something amazing happens. He starts to reveal himself in your life and in the lives of those around you. He starts to work. So guess who gets the glory when God works? He does. Not you, not me. Guess who gets the praise? Guess who gets the attention as the Holy Spirit guides the way? The Ethiopian, the eunuch, was at the point where his heart was receptive to the word of God, so it started to bear fruit. It was that good soil I talked about just a moment ago. And now Philip, he goes with the Ethiopian, and something amazing happens in this transaction. You see, the Holy Spirit provides the way. What we do is we receive and believe the word of God. Did you notice all three times when it talks about God preparing the way and guiding and providing, how all the three responses to that are how we respond to his word, hearing and obeying, hear, receiving and believing? That's intentional because what we're doing here is we're not making this about a felt needs emphasis, where if you have a need that you think you have, whether you self-diagnose and you think you've got it all figured out on your own or not, that's not where we start. It's not about, well, I need this in this area or this category, or I feel lost in this area or this category. What happens is we start with God's Word. And this is so vital, not just in evangelism, but in fellowship, in worship, in discipleship, and in service. In every purpose of the body of Christ, you don't start with you, you start with Him. You don't start with what you think, you start what He says. You don't start with, well, I'd really like to fill in the blank. What you start with is, what does He want? When you say, I want to know God's will for my life, that's not a bad question, but the right question is, I want to know God's will. How does my life fit into His will? You don't start with you, you start with Him. And what He's doing, Philip with the eunuch, Philip with the Ethiopian. I feel bad calling him a eunuch because I'm sure that's not his last name, but that's how he's referred to in the passage. What Philip did with the nice guy from down south is he saw him as God led him to engage with him the Word of God. Philip didn't give him the top 10 reasons that a foreigner needs to accept Jesus. Philip didn't go through saying, well, if you'll accept Jesus, then you'll have all the money you ever need. You'll be healthy, wealthy, and wise. And if you just give $10 into the offering plate, you'll get $100 back next week. He doesn't do any of that. He starts with the Word of God. Because only God can draw people to Himself. Only God causes people to seek after Him. Only God convicts the world of guilt. Only God convicts the world of righteousness. Only God convicts the world of judgment. Only God does these things. And when we leave it in God's hands, something amazing happens. Not passively, but active faith. Something amazing happens. We get to be participants in the movement of God. We get to let Him use us as instruments of righteousness to be reconcilers for His name. John Cheeseman, he said this, evangelism is not a making of proselytes. It is not persuading people to make a decision. It is not proving that God exists or making a good case for the truth of Christianity. It is not inviting someone to a meeting. It is not exposing the contemporary dilemma or arousing interest in Christianity. It is not wearing a badge saying Jesus saves. Some of these things are right and good in their place, but none used with evangelism. To evangelize is to do the authority of God what He has done to save sinners, to warn men of their lost condition, to direct them to repent, and to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. The book of Acts is not about Philip. It's not about the apostles. It's not about the early church. It's about the Holy Spirit. And when we get to chapter 8, we have the main character saying, I got you to this point. I'm going to get you all the way. I got you where you needed. I got you where you're needed right now. And I've got you going forward. Is it possible that instead of living by faith, is it possible that you actually believe that you're in charge? Maybe this morning, God brought you here for His purposes and for His glory. Maybe He had you read a certain thing, hear a certain person, engage in a certain conversation, not just so that you could just waddle through the world, but because He is moving and working, whether you see it or not. Maybe those of you who call yourselves believers in Jesus Christ, maybe we should take a little less credit for how He put that person or those people or that church in our path. Maybe He softens your heart as only He can so that you can respond to Him. And maybe, just maybe, this very moment the Spirit of God is working in your life in a way that you honestly don't fully understand but thrills your soul. Because you realize that it's not about you and it's about Him. You realize that if He loves me this much to bring my heart to discipline, to prune me, to correct me, to convict me, that means that I'm not lost to Him, that He still loves me, He still knows me. Amen and amen. Maybe this morning, what the Word of God is doing for you, not my opinion, not your opinion, not anybody else's ideas, but what the Word of God is doing for you is showing you your need for a Savior. You don't start with people. You don't start with circumstances. You don't start with environment. You don't start with history. You start with Jesus. And His Word In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And as you understand this Logos, as you understand His movement, something amazing happens. Your faith is not rested upon your understanding, but on Him. Your faith is not rested on my persuasion, but upon Him. Your faith is not rested upon your power, your strength, your wisdom, but on Him. You're not saved by someone talking you into something. You're not lost by someone talking you out of something. You're saved, you are contained, you are assured because of the Word of God. That's your faith. And there's something amazing that happens. Because then we come back to Acts chapter 1, verse 8. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Do you think it was an accident that God has you right where you are? It wasn't an accident when you were a child. It wasn't an accident when you were a young adult or an older adult. It's not an accident. Your past, your present, and your future. It's not an accident how God moves. It's not an accident what God does. Sometimes how we interpret, sometimes how we respond, they're wrong. But He's not. Sometimes we don't get it, but that doesn't mean He doesn't. Sometimes we don't understand, but that doesn't mean He is clueless. When you and I come to this point of faith of realizing that the same God who created the heavens and the earth is the same God who calls you out of darkness into light, something amazing happens in your heart, and you turn to Jesus to let Him be involved. The reason for the last month or so that we've been talking about who is your one is not for just for the lost to be found, which is incredible. It's not to encourage those of you who have been spending time praying for those you've already been praying for, which is amazing. If nothing else, I thank God for how many people I've discovered over the last few weeks. They don't brag about it. They don't talk about it to everybody, but how many people they've been praying for already. And they kept telling me, Pastor, we're going to keep doing it. Whether you do this program or not, we're going to keep doing it. Amen and amen. But that's really not the point. That's not the big point of who is your one. It's not to save the lost, although that's huge. It's not to raise our soul consciousness, which I think is great. It's not to get an idea that you are actually responsible to listen to God and obey God and let His Word guide you, which I think is superb. The whole point of this is to make who is your one the one. It's to glorify God more than anyone or anything else, more than you can breathe. To say God and His gospel means more to me than a person or a place or a circumstance. More than any relationships, more than any connections, any popularity or prestige, that God is my one. And because He's my one, everything about me is going to be toward Him. My heart is not going to be captured by what people think or the enslavement of the fear of man. I am going to be captured by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that means more than just the occasional impulse to tell someone about Jesus, or the unpleasant duty, let me do it so that I'll feel better about myself later. It means that you are so captivated, that you are so in love with and saved you, that you can't help but bubble on over. You can't help but care about those He's put on your heart. And so what happens in movements like these and in opportunities like these is one of two things. The first is that some of us will realize we never knew Jesus to begin with. And I got to welcome you to the family if that's you. I got to ask you to come. I've got to ask you to respond to Him right here and right now, to receive and believe. John chapter 1, verse 12. Those who believe, those who receive, they became children of God. If that's your calling, if that's what He's doing on you, then I ask you to continue with that and come forward in just a few moments as we have invitation. That's one category. The other category could be those of you who are following Christ, who have known Him perhaps for months, if not years, if not decades, and there's this apathy, there's this indifference toward other people and their souls and their need for salvation. You read verses like Luke chapter 15 that talk about the angels rejoice over the repenting of one lost sinner, and you think to yourself, well, that's really nice, but you've lost it. There's this disconnect. Can I tell you the hope is not in you and it's not in me, it's in Him. And His Word tells us that if we confess our sins, that He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So what you do with that guilt, what you do with that conviction, what you do with that shame is instead of just dwelling in it and kind of walking around it and even getting comfortable in it, you come to Jesus. Do you remember what I just said? The one. And you let Him be the attention. You let Him be the focus. And you say, Lord, my heart is cold. Search me and know my heart. Lord, I don't care as much as I think You want me to. Make me new. So when He answers that prayer, and He will, Who gets the glory? He does. How many times do you try to do this in your own strength, in your own effort, in your own will? And how many times, just by humbling ourselves before a gracious and a loving God, will He give us the power to be the witness in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world? As the musicians come forward, we're going to move into a time of invitation. If you're here this morning and you've heard this gospel, this truth about Jesus and how He loves you, how you receive and believe the Word of God, and you've never responded to that, I want to encourage you to come forward. We're going to have pastors and deacons at the front. They're here to pray with you, to share with you. It may be that you don't want to talk to any human being, and I respect that. You're going to at some point, but we'll talk about that later. But if you want to come to the altar and you want to just spend some time with your Lord, that's what the altar is for, or just where you are, this is the opportunity for that. I began this morning asking you to kind of tune in, and I want to thank you for that. But what's going to happen over the next few seconds is you're going to transition after I pray, and you're going to stand up, and some of you are going to tune out. You're going to go ahead and move on to what's next. And I get that. I've done that, been there, done that. I've got the T-shirt. I want to ask you, as I'm praying, would you please ask Him to help you to hear and obey? Whatever that is, that's the invitation. Would you pray with me, please? Lord, I thank You for the example of Philip. I thank You for how you move. And Lord, we give You the praise, the thanks, and the glory for what You do. So now, Lord, I ask that we fall in line with You. Speak. Your servants are listening. Give us what You, by Your grace and Your will, want to give us. And let us respond in faith for Your glory and according to Your word for our good. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with me, please?
Jesus, the full in me.
Remain standing for just a moment. We're going to introduce to you, Jacob and Bailey Meeks. You want to come on up. Jacob has accepted Christ. So if you how old is the baby? 6 weeks, 6 weeks. But they were here right before the birth, and they came right after the birth, so there should be some award or something. Anyway, if you're a member of First Baptist and you want to hold this precious family in prayer and accountability, help them grow in the Lord, allow them to do the same for you, would you please say amen?
Yeah. Amen.
We're going to let you guys stay up here, and then after we close in prayer, if you wouldn't mind making your way up, we're going to introduce you. Yeah, bring them. Yes. Absolutely. If we get the deacons to come up, we've got a serious heart surgery tomorrow for Miss Nancy. So we're going to close in prayer and let the deacons come and gather. Would y'all mind gathering? Or if you're not a deacon, if you would like to be, or if you just want to come pray for Nancy. So I tell you what, would you mind leading in a word of prayer for Nancy and as well as dismissing? Thank you very much.
Shall we bow before the throne of grace? Our Father, as we come to you this morning, we just want to lift Nancy before you. You know exactly what her physical condition is and just what she needs. Father, we ask for wisdom for the doctors that they would be able to counsel correctly. But Father, we know that you're the great physician. You do the healing. But we thank you for the doctors that are there. And Father, for each of our lives, you know what we need too. And many times it's just to be able to walk with you, to be in obedience, as was Philip. So many blessings we miss out on because we're not doing what you told us to do. Father, forgive us. Father, as we go through this week and working with you, working for you, we thank you for Jacob and Bailey who have chosen to become members of this church, that we can be a blessing to them and they to us is their walk with you as well. So, Father, we ask you to use us, each and every one, according to your will and not just what we want. Thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' precious name, for his glory, amen. Thank you. God bless.